A scripture used by the churchmen in our day for the assertion that we are to always obey the civil authorities is Romans 13. But is this true? Does Romans 13 really teach unlimited obedience to the state? When people read Romans 13, they often fail to recognize the limitation clauses that Paul attaches to the text. In verses 3 and 4, the scriptures make clear that the function of the civil authority is to reward those who do good and to punish those who do evil. But when the magistrates pervert their God-given function and begin to punish those who do good and reward those who do evil, men have the duty and the right to obey God rather than man. It is interesting that when it comes to the three great governments, family government, church government, and civil government, people automatically understand that the authority, for example, in family government that the parents possess is not unlimited authority. Even though when the scripture says there in the Word of God, children obey your parents, it has no limitation clauses, everyone understands that does not mean that the parents' authority is unlimited. For example, if a father told his child, you go down to the gas station on the corner and rob it, because you're only 12, and if you get caught, you'll get a slap on the wrist. But if I rob it and get caught, I'll go to prison for years. No one would fault the child for not obeying his father. And when it comes to church government, there in Hebrews 13, it says simply, obey those who have the rule over you. No limitation clauses. Yet no one takes that authority by church leadership to be unlimited. For example, if a pastor was caught by one of his congregants skimming money out of the offering plate and he told the congregant, don't tell the elders, no one would fault the congregant for telling the elders. But yet for some reason, when it comes to civil authority, where there are limitation clauses, everyone thinks we are to always obey the civil authorities. And that is simply not true. It is something churchmen have taught them and have imposed upon the text. They are committing what is known as an act of eisegesis. Eis is the Greek word for into. Eisegesis means you are reading into the text something that is not there. We want to do exegesis, where we explain the scripture by drawing out the original intended meaning of the author to the hearers. Nowhere does Romans 13 or 1 Peter 2 say that we are to always obey the civil authorities. In fact, there is not a single verse in all the Bible that says we are to always obey the civil government. We want to do proper biblical hermeneutics. Theologians and scholars define biblical hermeneutics as the science and art of biblical interpretation. Good hermeneutics demands that we not read a verse or a passage in a vacuum. The hallmark of good hermeneutics is Scripture interprets Scripture. In other words, every individual scripture, scripture with a small s, must be interpreted in light of the whole of God's Word, scripture with a big S. Scripture interprets scripture. When we look at the whole of God's Word, we see that there are many passages which contradict the assertion that we are to always obey the government. For example, Exodus 1, verses 15 through 21 records the story of the Hebrew midwives who were commanded by the king to kill the male Hebrew babies. The scripture says the midwives feared God and therefore refused to kill the male babies. God commended them for their actions, as the scripture states. Therefore, God dealt with the midwives and the people multiplied and grew very mighty. In Daniel chapter 6, we read that the king declared that no one could pray to any deity but only to him. Notice that this law was made in clear contradiction to the Word of God. This was a classic showdown where the law of man violated, opposed, and contradicted the law and Word of God. Did Daniel obey this law? Did he say, oh, that's a bad law, but we must always obey the state? No. Daniel took a brave and open stand in defiance of this unjust law. The scripture says that when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home. And in his upper room, with his windows open towards Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees three times that day and prayed and gave thanks before his God. Notice he knew of the unjust law. Notice his windows were open so all could see his non-compliance with the law. Notice he knelt down on his knees so no one could mistake his defiance of the law. and he did it three times to ensure being noticed. If the assertion is true that God's people are always to obey the laws and orders of the state, this passage stands in complete contradiction to it. Other passages also contradict the assertion that we are to always obey the state. For example, Hebrews 11:23 records how Moses' parents disobeyed the king. The scripture reads, "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command." This is recorded in what Christians call the Hall of Fame of Faith. Their actions are commended by the Word of God. In the fifth chapter of Acts, the apostles were told by the authorities not to preach about Jesus. They refused to obey them and responded by saying, "We ought rather to obey God than men." When human authority contravenes the law or word of God, we have a duty to obey God rather than man. Matthew 2, verses 1 through 11 recounts how the Magi disobeyed King Herod. They were warned by God himself not to obey the king. So rather than obey the king and return to Jerusalem to tell where Jesus could be found, they departed for their own country another way. And in 2 Corinthians 11, verses 32 and 33, Paul talks about how he avoided the government officials who were attempting to arrest him by escaping down the side of the city wall in a basket. Paul, who penned Romans 13, knew the government officials were trying to arrest him, but rather than submit and obey, he craftily fled. Again, if the assertion is true that God's people are always to obey the laws and orders of the state, these passages stand in complete contradiction to it. In conclusion, Romans 13 does not teach that the government officials possess unlimited authority, nor does it teach that we are to give them unlimited submission.